transfer of 2 units then come from individual 3 to individual 2. So again, you have a progressive transfer. And that is the reason why, once you have a progressive transfer, you must have Lorentz dominance. That is why A also Lorentz dominates C. But what can you say about B and C? What is happening between B and C is, you have two kinds of transfers taking place. You have a transfer of 2 units from this guy, from the second guy to the first guy, so that the first guy's income goes up to 12, and the second guy's income comes down to 18. Okay? Now that's a progressive transfer. But what you're doing then is compensating that with a regressive transfer. Now he has 18, you're taking 2 away from him and giving it to the richer guy to make his income 32 and bring his income down to 16. So you have 2 transfers in the transition from B to C, of which one is progressive and the other is regressive. So you have an inherent ambiguity here about what should actually be happening to the Lorentz curve. And that ambiguity reflects itself in a situation in which neither curve dominates the other, but the two intersect one. So the moral of the lesson is very simple. If you can derive one income vector from another one of the same dimension and size through a sequence of finite transfers which are progressive, then Lorentz dominance will obtain. Otherwise, you will have Lorentz intersection. And that is the reason why the Lorentz dominance relationship is a strict partial ordering. It is not a complete ordering, it is a partial ordering. And now I just want to wind up by saying that what did we start out with talking about? That one component of welfare surely is equality. And the Lorentz curve and the Lorentz dominance relationship associated with it furnishes you with one way in which you can compare distributions in terms of their equality. The comparison may not always be complete, but it does furnish you with a way of comparing two distributions in terms of their equality. But equality, remember, is not the only component of welfare. Efficiency also matters. In other words, presumably, we should be concerned not only with the extent of inequality in the distribution of income, but with the size of the total pie which is being distributed. Your question about countries with different average incomes. How do we deal with welfare comparisons in which it is not only equality but also efficiency which matters, and there you have recourse to a dominance relationship called generalized Lorentz dominance, which is due to a person called Shorrox, which I will deal with tomorrow. Okay, so we will stop here and I will invite any questions if you have any. But this was just by way of preliminary preparation, so that Lorentz curves, Lorentz dominance, generalized Lorentz dominance, stochastic dominance, progressive transfers, permuted vectors, and so on and so forth, are par for the course when you're dealing with inequality measurement. So if you familiarize with these notions, you never need to be defeated by them, because they sound a little awe-inspiring, but actually once you've understood what they mean, they say very simple things. So that was the reason why I thought it was important to invest in some basic fundamental concepts at the outset. Okay, end of sermon. You can ask your questions.
Sir, I have a question related to Pareto optimality condition. If we are looking at this, the dominant log-in curve.
Good question.
So how we are able to relate this with the Pareto optimality?
Okay, the only connection is that the Pareto relationship, the notion of Pareto superiority, we say x p star y means that x is Pareto preferred to y. P star is again a binary relationship which is not complete. Just as Lorentz dominance is a binary relationship which is not complete. Because everybody may not prefer x to y, some might prefer x to y, some might prefer y to x, in which case you can say neither x p star y nor y p star x. In exactly the same way in which with intersecting Lorentz curves, you may not be able to say either x and dy nor y to dy. So both of these are examples of binary relationships which share the property of incompleteness. They share the property of transitivity. They share the property of irreflexivity. and they also share the property of asymmetry. So in fact, the Pareto relationship, like the Lorentz dominance relationship, is, and I've just learned this from you now, this moment, is a strict partial order. Any other questions?
Respect to rank preserving transfer, now what if there are individuals who are between J and K? Transfer from J to some amount of transfer to J, will it two ranks in this for equal life?
Okay. Supposing next to J there is a guy called L. So will this transfer push J above L? What we will assume to keep things absolutely simple is that no ranks are changed. Okay. We will simply assume that all ranks are there. So the restriction which I put on delta guarantees only an absence of rank change between J and K. It does not guarantee the absence of rank change amongst others. So it is only a sufficient condition for it's only a necessary condition for preserving all ranks. It's not a sufficient condition. But let's not complicate that. I mean, for the time being, it doesn't really matter whether other people. It does actually. So let's assume that this is rank preserving across the board. Doesn't matter. I'll tell you that it actually doesn't matter. It actually doesn't matter. Because even if that other guy gets a smaller income now, the gap between that person and the original person will be smaller than it was initially.
Delta will be
the same recording, so that all the next steps. Yes. Yeah, there was another question. Can you shout, please? No.
In what manner is Lorentz dominance a better measure over stochastic dominance?
A better measure for what?
Stochastic dominance.
Can you repeat the question, somebody?
What way Lorentz dominance is much better than stochastic dominance?
Oh, what is the, okay. Okay, just take it from me. Go back and work it out, okay? Typically, where do you employ second-order stochastic dominance? In fact, this was something which Anthony Atkinson employed in his work on inequality measurement. He noticed that there was a certain formal correspondence, a certain formal structural similarity between expected utility analysis of uncertain prospects and inequality comparisons. Now, you replace X, Y, and so on by prospects. Now, what is a prospect? A prospect is an array of different outcomes. Okay? So think of, supposing you are thinking about agriculture, and a prospect will consist of levels of output corresponding to monsoon failure, medium monsoon, and good monsoon. Okay? So you can have three different elements, like three different income levels. Now you can also attach certain probabilities to these outcomes. What's the probability it's going to be completely dry? What's the probability that it'll be a reasonably good year? What's the probability it's going to be a really good year? Okay. So when you compare prospects like X and Y, okay, what you tend to do is to employ the criterion of expected utility. That is, you define utility over each of these states of affairs. You weight them by the probabilities of occurrence. Okay. And that will give you the expected utility of prospect X and the expected utility of prospect Y. Now, when can you say that for a certain class of utility functions, okay, that one prospect will have an expected utility always greater than another prospect? And the class of utility functions which is generally employed is the class of increasing and strictly concave equilibrium. Now it can be shown that one prospect can be said to be unambiguously reflective of a higher expected utility than another prospect whenever it is the case that the first prospect second order stochastically dominates the second prospect. Now if you think about it, structurally we are saying the same thing about inequality. There you are dealing with uncertainty or risk, which is a bad, in exactly the way in which inequality is a bad. And just as you compare uncertain prospects in terms of expected utility, so you can compare distributions in terms of inequality. And therefore, it can be demonstrated, and it was shown by Atkinson, that the property of second order stochastic dominance in expected utility analysis corresponds to the property of Lorentz dominance of income distribution. So that is the relationship between second order stochastic dominance and Lorentz dominance. Now this is going to be, you have anticipated an important question which I don't think I'm going to have time to deal with in this set of lectures. But when we're making welfare comparisons, again when you're dealing with welfare functions which are defined over the set of individual utility functions that are increasing and strictly concave, you have a rule for saying when welfare from one distribution will be unambiguously greater than welfare from another distribution, it turns out that the criterion is Lorentz dominance. If one distribution Lorentz dominates the other, then there is a class of welfare functions, what are called, in fact, increasing and strictly sure concave social welfare functions, which satisfy this property. Exactly analogously to the way in which expected utility from one prospect. Prospect can be seen to be greater than another prospect through the medium of second order stochastic dominance. By the way, do you know what the term stochasticity means? Uncertainty. Yeah, we're dealing with probabilities. So that's why when we're dealing with income distributions, what is the frequency with which a particular income appears? That can vary across distributions. So the probability distributions of these incomes are different across distributions. And that is where stochasticity enters. Another question?
Sir, I have a question related to the Lorentz curve and convexity condition. Do this, we have drawn three Lorentz curves here. We draw linear Lorentz curves. Probability is that they will overlap also and intersect also. But do they follow convexity condition which we use in the state theory?
Yes.
And we are generally saying that indifference curve and all. So same property can we apply here?
No.
Indifference curve we say that upper indifference curve give us more satisfaction. So
that's true, but in the indifference curves are defined differently. By the definition of an indifference curve.
I am talking in terms of state theory condition.
Yeah. So in whatever theory, I mean, an indifference curve by definition is such that it can never intersect another indifference curve. Because the utility along an indifference curve is held constant.
Right?
So if you have two indifference curves which intersect, utility here is the same as utility here. Utility here is the same as utility here. But utility here is the same as utility here. So you can't have these two cars intersecting each other. But you have no such constraint on a Lorentz curve. So Lorentz curves will typically intersect.
And in terms of convexity condition? Convex statement?
Yes. In general, the Lorentz curve will be convex. I mean, it might have certain flat parts. It might have parts which are flat or which are linear or whatever. But if those linear segments are smaller and smaller, then through the property of continuity, they will all approximate to generally a smooth convex curve. So, but you can have sections of the Lorentz curve, which are like this. I mean, you can have a Lorentz curve like that. this can be flagged. That's possible. But if you take the entire curve, see, this is a problem of differentiability at this point. It can be convex, but it may not be differentiable uniformly. But generally, we make the assumption in order to make our own lives a little more convenient that these curves are smoothly convex, that is to say, indefinitely differentiable. Any other questions? Nobody else who asks a question is going to incur the unpopularity of the rest of the class. But anyway, I'm available. So if you have a question, go ahead and ask. Otherwise, we'll break with the understanding that you have some relief for the next week, 2 days. Professor Mukherjee will be handling your lectures tomorrow and the day after. And we'll meet again on Thursday. Okay? Thank you.